that scrutiny. Mm-hmm. You've seen some real giants of your industry, Harvey Weinstein, Kevin Spacey, and others, who have been, I guess exposed is the wrong word, but who have been identified as sexual harassers, sexual abusers, or at least there are allegations of that.
Yeah, allegations. They're calling them predators.
Allegations. Predators. Predators. Yeah. Predators. How pervasive is that in the industry itself, and how complicit is everyone who has been around it all these years and not said anything about it?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, anybody who had like very specific knowledge of what was going on, they'll have to answer questions about, you know, how complicit were they.
You saw a lot of stars, people you've acted with.
Rightly so.
But they came forward after these very brave women who were not prominent and who were not powerful told their stories to the New York Times, told them to Ronan Farrow Yorker.
Yeah. I think there's a number of reasons people go into this line of work that I'm in, essentially trying to come up with stories that people will pay to see. One is because it's less, just ridiculous amounts of fun. Two is, if you can make it stick, it can be a pretty good living, you know, and you get to travel the world and see interesting things. Some people do it for power. They just want to have a degree of power because that's the thing that gives them credence. It's something, you know, on one hand, it's a parking space with your name on it, and to take it to another extreme, it's the ability to beat up on underlings and say things like, so you want a job? You want to keep your job? Well, then you're going to have to fulfill these other demands I have on you that are of a sexual nature. That is pure harassment. It's, to the degree of assault. There are people like that, without a doubt, in Hollywood. I don't think it is it's not common core, but without a doubt, it's widespread. Because human nature comes down to, a lot of times those people in power have it for that ability, that access, in order to be a sexual predator.
Well, we've seen it in politics.
Well, it's everywhere.
We've seen it in business.
But you know, part of it also is, goes like, look, we all left town and joined the circus, and the circus is glamorous in a lot of ways, and. There is camaraderie, and there is sex, and there's attraction, and there's boyfriends and girlfriends, and there's flirting, and that's always been part of theirs. Onset affairs. There's no law against that.
But this goes far beyond.
This goes much farther beyond that, because it ends up being a swaying of influence, and it becomes part of the marketplace. It becomes, when it is inherent into the workforce that you join, that you have to succumb to a degree of sexual harassment in order to keep your job. When that happens, the only thing you can say is, number one, I hope the victims come out and tell all sorts of stories, everything, tell the truth about what goes on, and that the repercussions land exactly as they should.
Well, were you surprised by some of these revelations?
I'm surprised by the overtness of it. Yeah, sure. Yes, absolutely. Am I surprised at some of the personalities involved? Not Harvey. Mm-hmm. You know, he had a way of doing business and, you know, a zero-sum game, negotiation stuff that would not make you surprised to have him be one of those kind of guys that does that in the workplace. Others are just like, well, there's a time and place for decorum and ethics, and you blew it. You know, there's that as well.
Do you think that there'll be scripts written about this, about these women who lived in terror, or will Hollywood protect itself from that?
Oh no, I think there's going to be quite a bit that's going to come out about it. And here's what's going to be an interesting test: is that going to be salacious, titillating, shocking, outrageous in order to draw viewers, or is it going to be human and realistic and authentic in its details in order to say what happened? In some ways, you can already see, you know, I'm sure there's already stories in development that are going to be based on the Harvey Weinstein or whatever. And is that going to be as what's the word I'm looking for? Is that going to be as pure an examination of the theme as somebody else taking along and saying, well, let's fictionalize it and turn it into something so that we're not necessarily dealing with the specifics of any one person, but can get down to the specifics of what it really did to the human beings as well.
Do you think films like that, or let's talk about Philadelphia, which sure. was a brave film in 1993, do you think they have the power to change things? Do you think Philadelphia hastened an understanding of age?
I think it did, both in what it accomplished and what it failed to accomplish. The throwing deep in the end zone on Philadelphia was that it was going to compete in the open marketplace. You could make a small movie for $400,000 and you could play in every film festival in the world, and only 62,000 people will see it. It will be a profoundly good movie to them. But when you're going out and you're going to compete in your local marketplace for a broad audience to come in and deal with something that is kind of ripped right out of today's headlines, you have to do it in a manner that it's going to be somehow so approachable, authentic, and glamorous in order to attract an audience who simply wants to be entertained. If they become enlightened at the same time, good for you. But there's throughout all of American history, and which I have said, a gentleman's agreement with Gregory Peck in 1952 was about anti-Semitism that no one had ever touched before. The Best Years of Our Lives was about the emptiness that an entire generation faced when they came back from the war. And how in the world do they get on with that? You can go, The Grapes of Wrath. I mean, even though the ending was absolutely nothing like John Steinbeck wrote, it ended up being entering into the national consciousness and changing that consciousness, because you could not argue with the theme that it was examining. And Hollywood will do that all the time. It won't always land on it. It won't always make it happen. It might cop out periodically, but there's always going to be something coming down the pike that is meant to do it. The difference now is it might be on, you know, you might be on a streaming service as opposed to playing in your local cinema, because the superheroes are filling up all the cinemas.
Coming up next.
Could you play this president of the United States?
Oh, I think a lot of people could. Yeah, yeah.
How would you play him? You've probably seen the stuff written and said about, well, why don't we run Tom Hanks
yeah,
for president?
Yeah, well, that's
how would you like to play that role?
I don't even want to play the president of the United States, much less be the president of the United
could
States.
Could you play this president of the United States?
Oh, I think a lot of people could. Yeah, yeah.
How would you play him?
I would probably play him as a very incurious man. And I do it in interpretation more so than incurious and an unimaginative guy who doesn't see much beyond the next 48 hours. Here, let's come this way. Can you get a shot of this? Do you know what this is?
It looks to be a television set.
Not just any television set. This is a communist television set. This was on the set of Bridge of Spies. Never make a movie with Steven Spielberg and said, hey man, this is a good, yeah, look at this little communist TV. That looks like it's a lot of fun. Next thing you know, it's being delivered to your house. So this was, you know, you could make your own records on
wow.
tape. And you could have, you know, look at this old microphone, some
holy
old headphones.
Smokes. This is quite a rig.
No, this was a big deal. I didn't even know this stuff was in here. I'm discovering it right now. Shall we put this on and see what it says? Maybe we should.
It could be Khrushchev. So you mentioned Bridge of Spies. You've done so many of these sort of historical pieces, biopics. Are you drawn to those? Do you find those?
Only when they're mysterious and create something brand new. And when there is a dynamic to the character that I think speaks greater than the nostalgia for the period.
Ben Bradley, these people are known. I mean, Ben Bradley hasn't been gone that long. Mm-hmm. A lot of people know him. A lot of people worked for him, with him. He was an icon of Washington, pillar of Washington. Does it make it harder When people know these people, I mean, does it put more pressure on you?
It is a pressure, but we set out in order to obey a couple of rules. I played Richard Phillips, who was kidnapped by Somali pirates.
Captain Phillips, and
Sully Sullenberger and Charlie Wilson, the congressman when he was alive. And then you have a meeting with them and you have to say to them, look, in this movie, I'm going to say things you never said and do things you never did, and I'm going to be places you never were. Despite those handicaps, I wanted to be as realistic as possible. If you're aiming out in order to not alter the motivations of anybody or to a ridiculous degree for the sake of dramatic purposes, the order of events, well, then you can live up to, I think, the truth of is if you're making a movie about something that really happened, for good or for bad, it becomes a document. It becomes a version of events that people will turn to as being an authoritative source of this moment of history. And you can't play fast and loose with that reality. You actually have to adhere as close as you can to the facts.
You illustrate your book with photos, I presume, of some of these typewriters.
It's not the first typewriter you get that's important. It's the second typewriter that determines you're a collector. Because if you buy a typewriter you don't need because you already have a typewriter, what does that say about you?
How many do you have now?
Well, come on, sure.
All right.
These are all various stages of they kind of work, they don't work, they need servicing, they're too big, whatever. These have all been edited. I have gone through the whole collection. I pulled out every one. I made sure they worked. They're all in working order.
And do you use them?
Yeah, I rotate them. I rotate them into use, and I can tell them by the cases. There's some Smith Coronas. This will be a Selectomatic. There's some more Hermes.
So tell me, I mean, you already asserted that it is some reflection of insanity, but what is it about these that cause you to collect them?
This machine tells the truth, and it also tells lies. It can change the world for the good or the better. Listen to that. See that? See that? Hear that report? Now, the only thing you can do on this is record your thoughts. That's the only thing that it's good for. It's the only thing that it's meant for. But if you're going to say, I love you to somebody, it's as permanent as though it was going to be carved in stone.
So many of your projects are sort of these sepia memories of another time. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me these are as well. You have a fondness for an era. You have a fondness for a time.
I think I have a fondness for a limited technology that was closed-ended. You know, a clock was meant to do only one thing, tell you the time. A camera did one thing. It took a photograph of you. I am as much as enmeshed in my iPhone as much as possible. But of late, I removed every game from it. I've taken off every news update service of it. I've gotten rid of all sorts of stuff that sends me information that I just check as opposed to read.
Yeah.
And it's actually made my life a little bit more cohesive.
Ahead on the Axefiles.
I gotta tell you, there's times I've lied through my teeth, sometimes in promoting movies that even I knew weren't even good.
I will say that polling has gotten a bad rap. So I tell you this advisedly, but you know, every poll I look at says Tom Hanks is the most trusted, Tom Hanks is the most beloved and popular actor. So,
isn't that right, guys? Give me a big huzzah.
So you must be.
They're not allowed to say
anything. You've made that connection for a very long time, and that's an enormous accomplishment.
Well, I don't discount that. I don't. That says something. This is the way I take it is that, my countenance, if I should be so bold, matches my choices. You know, I think that's when you get to this point where you realize you're a bit of a commodity, and I realize I am, you know, from a business perspective, and the people who want me to do business with them, I understand I'm bringing into it the sum of everything I've ever done, everything I've ever said, yeah. Any reaction any audience has ever had. And
so probably don't screw it up now.
One, don't screw it up, but at the same time, you must stretch it somehow, mm-hmm. because otherwise all you are is a bottle of Coca-Cola.
Right.
You need to provide some other brand of nourishment and healthiness. And so if those kind of very flattering polls, or people say, they say, what better thing could you hear about yourself other than, hey, I trust you.
Yes.
That's about the highest praise you could get from anybody. And I got to tell you, there's times I've lied through my teeth, sometimes in promoting movies that even I knew weren't any good. But you can still get into that, an understanding of sometimes you take a shot, sometimes you don't. But, you know, countenance matching up with the quality of the choices you make, that's, outside of longevity, that's the only standard you can hold yourself to.
Well, Tom Hanks, it's pleasure to be with
you. I'm exhausted, David. Have I pontificated enough?
We're gonna give you a rest. No, it's really so good to be with you, and I
appreciate thank you. I enjoyed talking to you.
To hear more of my conversation with Tom Hanks, go to iTunes.com/Axefiles.